Hello, and in today's video I'm going to be setting up the base project we're going to use to program the ATmega328P. So first what we do is we go to File, we say New, we say Project, and then we just select GCC Executable Project. You can also select GCC C++, but for all intents and purposes I'm going to be using a C project. Then we can just name the project. We're just going to call this one Setup. And then you can select the location and you can choose a different name for the solution. It does not really matter what the third name is. Then we just click OK. Then we need to select our device. We can just search it here, which is ATmega328P. And you want to make sure you're selecting the P version, not the PB version. The PB version has slightly different peripherals and register locations. So we select the ATmega328P, we click OK, and it will create the project for us. Then we are greeted with a file like as follows. And now I need to remember where my project tree is. Okay, if your project solution has disappeared like mine has, you just go to View, you go to Solution Explorer, and then it should pop up here on the side. Then you right click Setup, you say Add, it's a new item, and we are going to add a include file, and we are going to name this include file config. Add that to the solution. It will generate a base header file for you. If you want to add an existing item or a library from somewhere, you say add library, or you say add and you say existing item, and then just browse to the file that you want to add additionally. Now in the config file we add a hash define and we say if underscore CPU. Now this is a special macro that is used by other libraries to just to tell the library we are running at X amount of megahertz. In this case, we're running with 16 megahertz CPU. So we say 16, 1, 2, 3, and then 1, 2, 3 for 16 million hertz. Then we go back to our C main file, and right at the top, your very first include into the main will be hash include, and we just say config. And this should be your very, very, very first include. And for future reference, any configuration definition, I'm going to put into this file. And then you save the project. This is all you need for the basic setup. Then we go to our device programming. We apply, and then we go to fuses. Then in fuses, by default, it is set to auto read. I have disabled it. I'm going to manual read it and just resize it. Unfortunately, it does not save the resize when you close it down for some reason. I don't like it. But anyways, now these fuses are how the chip is physically configured. The base configuration for it to start up. So our first configuration is the brownout reset. If the voltage drops below 2.7 volts, then it will automatically start resetting the chip. It's a SME trigger style reset, so it drops below that voltage and then waits until a new threshold for it to restart the oscillator. Now you can select from 4.3 down to 1.8 volts and outright disable it. And since I have a read target voltage of between 4.5 to 5 volts, I am selecting the 2.7 volts. Actually, all of these bits are going to be the same as on an Arduino Uno. Our reset disable is unticked, so we want our reset enabled. So the reset pin can only reset. Then the next fuse is the debug wire enable. We're going to have that disabled. We have the SPI enable. You do not want to untick this. If you untick this, you will be unable to program your chips. This is for one-time programming the chip. And then we have the watchdog timer on. We want this also disabled. It will be covered later in a video. Then we have EE save, which basically every time you program the device, that it retains what is in the EE prompt. Then we have our boot sector size. So basically it's telling it when you reset the chip at what address it's supposed to start in the flash. So if you have the drop down here, you can see you can set at which addresses, and this is basically only for bootloaders. So you can basically increase the size of your bootloader. But we're going to keep that as default to where the Arduino vector is. And the next bit is the boot sector reset. From what I understand from the datasheet, this determines if it actually points to the above boot SE instead of pointing to address 0. Now it's going to point to address 3F00 on startup. Then we have our clock divider. We are disabling that. Basically, this just divides the clock frequency by 8. So since I have a 60 MHz, if I tick this, I'm going to run at 2 MHz. I don't want that. And then we have low clock out. That puts one of the pins to output a clock pulse at the clock frequency of the device. Then we have our oscillator selector, which I'm going to put at the last one. So we have a external 60 MHz clock with a slow start delay on it. Then we have other different ones for internal oscillators and stuff. The naming is a bit poor, but if you go through the datasheet and look at the SUT and the clock cell bits, it gives it comprehensive, but I will explain those in one of the later tutorials. Okay, so for now we select it. If yours doesn't have this, then you just simply click program, and if you change something, you will see it will give you an exclamation mark. And then we go to lock bits. You don't want to touch these bits. It will turn sections of the flash off, so you can't program them. If your fuses are set up correctly now, then you can just click program here. Then how we are going to program the device, we are going to have memories, and then you can see it already generates an ELF in the debug mode for us. And then we can just click program here for the device, and we can also erase the device if we want to. And that's the base project setup for a ATmega328P. A like, share, comment, and subscribe will be greatly appreciated. Thank you. Have a nice day. It's a Schmidt trigger.